For sure. And so while we're talking about evidence, let's talk about bad evidence.
Yes.
Because I have had clients come in with a conversation with their co-parent and, you know, well, she said this and she said that. And I go, okay, all right. So I like listen to it and like they both sound really, really bad, right? It's like you go like, there is no way I am playing that in the courtroom. I'm just going to tell you now. I mean, neither one of you better be putting that on because the judge will kick you both out of the courtroom. So, you know, there is such a thing as bad evidence. And so be very careful. And once you have engaged in, you know, I mean, when you're sharing custody, I just have to say, you just have to be on good behavior. I mean, we just got to do it. You just, I don't care how much you hate the other person. I don't care how much grief they've given you. You know, you've got to be on good behavior and you cannot lose your cool. And you don't need to be writing emails in all capital letters. And, you know, you don't need to be telling your co-parent that, you know, her mother was always a bitch to you. And, you know, you've got to, you know, you, if we need a whole training course on that, perhaps we do, but you know, you have to co-parent. You have to co-parent. And, you know, there's bad evidence. So don't get caught in bad evidence.
Hey, I tell clients that if you're going to send a written message, it better be uncomfortable to send because you're being so obnoxiously nice. Because I guarantee you one wrong word, all of a sudden the opposing counsel is going to be waving that and saying, he's threatening her. He's frustrated. He's angry. So before you hit send, you better be uncomfortable with how nice you're being to your co-parent.
Well, and I say this, I say, before you hit send, read that email out loud, like it's being read by a judge in a courtroom and see how it sounds. And then if it sounds okay, then you can hit send.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's we'll kind of transition. We'll be more dad specific here because one of the biggest mistakes I see just with the way the California Family Code is written is dads usually get themselves in trouble with what I'll call a mean text. So there's a lot of domestic violence restraining orders that essentially are framed around a handful of mean texts. So for you and your practice, California has a not the greatest law when it comes to that stuff, and they incentivize alleging domestic violence with the way the family code is written. In California, it's family code section 3044. If a party on preponderance of the evidence is found to have perpetuated domestic violence for 5 years, it's presumed that they should not have joint or sole legal or physical custody. So I see almost every single case, there's allegations of domestic violence that hinge on mean texts is what I call them. What do you see in your practice as some of the biggest mistakes that men make?
Okay. So before I get into that, though, I want to say something about Tennessee law and this new law. So there's another statute in Tennessee called 366406, which basically says just what you said. If there is a finding of abuse or threat to abuse against a parent or another sibling or the child, then it says that the court shall restrict parenting time. Okay. So, and I talked early on about we've got this new law, but there's always a way if you look at another law somewhere where it's going to get junked up. And I say this is one of the big problems with family law, which is all statutory. It's all by statute. There's no common law in family law. So you have statutes that are built layer on top of layer on top of layer on top of layer on top of layer. And you have General Assembly people who are making these laws who don't understand the comprehensive nature of the statutory scheme. However, the whole legislative interpretation law says that that a judge has to consider the statutory scheme. So you have this joint custody law here that says that it's presumption by preponderance of evidence of joint custody, unless by clear and convincing evidence, there's a reason that it should not be, right? However, you have 366406, which says that if by a preponderance of evidence, there's any evidence of physical, emotional, sexual, you know, abuse, parent, child, sibling, then parenting time's to be restricted. So I think that's going to be a problem. I think that's going to kind of muck things up for the joint custody law. So I just, you know, people need to stay aware of that. Now, I forget the question you asked me. I think it was about men. The biggest mistake.
I agree with you. And people have to realize, even when some of these states maybe have some misguided domestic violence laws that get passed, it's much easier for an elected official to vote for, because domestic violence is a serious issue. That shouldn't be downplayed, period. Mm-hmm. But it's much easier for an elected official to vote for stronger domestic violence laws than it is for them to loosen the restrictions or make it more difficult. So that's just going to happen because of the serious nature of domestic violence, and it does still happen.
Well, and you know that that's also based on federal funding too, right? The Violence Against Women Act, VAWA money flows to the states to have stronger domestic violence laws. So
there's California's 3044 came in was after the Violence Against Women Act immediately.
Yeah,
after.
Exactly. So that's financially, there's incentives there for that. So let's talk about dads. And I will say I have had some great dads as clients. I mean, I've had some awesome dads that we've come in and we've overturned prior custody decisions. I've had some great ones. And I will say that all of my great dads have listened to every word I said. I mean, they've been great at, and it's really kind of funny because I'm a woman and they're a man, and you know, you would think there might be some level of being misogynistic or something, but all of the great dads that I've had that we've won really good things have really, really listened to me. And I really try to encourage that. And I will also say there's another kind of class of dads that come in to see me and they know I have a good reputation. However, they're a little haughty and they're a little, oh, I've been abused and, you know, I've been beat up in the system. And I give them the, you know, wag my finger at them a little bit, but you know, they turn, the ones who are there and they turn around and listen to me, they also end up with very good results. So there's that bit of humility and being humble of kind of, but they've stayed strong. I mean, they're obviously very strong people that I've worked with and they're not weak and we've been able to get through it. I mean, there are dads that, you just can't get them to understand that, you know, maybe they are not, there are some dads that aren't really active parents. I mean, there are some dads that just, you know, they want to be a dad and they want to be a good time dad and have fun, but they really don't want that responsibility of co-parenting like the other parent does. And so I have to have really, really serious discussions with them and kind of find out where they are on that. Now, I don't want to leave this. I know we're going to get to the end of the hour, and this is a whole nother topic we can discuss another time. But the Title IV-D money and the way we handle child support is outrageous. It's just outrageous. So it's all based upon false facts. They're not even facts. It's the whole schedule, the calendar, all of that is crazy. So that's a whole nother discussion that has to do with shared parenting, but we have a long ways to go yet. And, you know, we have an uphill battle, but we need both parents on both sides, very, very well educated, very prepared, ready to work hard to get a good decision that they can live with going forward.
Yeah, definitely.